What are you thinking about in terms of how you, you know, what you hope to bring to this piece? And maybe talk a little bit about your other experiences you've had with Mahler in the past.
Well, Mahler is, for me, you know, sometimes when you ask a musician, what is your favorite piece? You never have it. Who is your favorite composer? You get this all the time. And my answer is, well, my answer is usually it's whoever I'm conducting that week. But I can tell you that Mahler won his first symphony. I mean, one of the pieces that if you were to send me to the moon, I want Mahler 1, especially the last movement, especially this first slow section of the last movement. I want La Bohème. I want all of James Taylor. I want, Blue Eyes Crying in the Rain, Willie Nelson. I can make the list, but certainly in the classical realm, Mahler is the guy that goes with me to the moon. I grew up musically listening to Mahler, and I'm okay with the fact that Mahler exposes me emotionally in places that sometimes I want to keep covered, which is one of the things that a lot of people, there are people who don't like Mahler, and I think some of those people who don't like Mahler don't like Mahler because he makes them be too honest with themselves, and I don't know how he gets to that, but that's always my reaction, and so. I spend my days singing something from the symphony, and I have been doing that for the last probably 3 weeks or so. Today my wife and I are walking the dog after, you know, my 6 hours and 4 hours, 5 hours, whatever it was, and sure enough, I'm walking through the park with the dogs trying to get to yadadadadum.
That could make for a very interesting walk with your dog. Like if you had a really big dog that pulled very hard, would be great.
And my dog's turning around going, "What? What?" But you know, it permeates my existence, and I'm just chomping at the bit to get to it. Wait, start it again. It's interesting that Mahler does a couple things dramatically to us. First, he grabs us by the throat with this gesture in the strings, in the violins and violas. And then he has them play piano for the rest of the, but then the cellos and the basses play four or five notes, followed by a fermata, a pause. So not only has Mahler done this in the beginning and created drama, an air of suspense, but he gives us what we think is the ball finally dropping to the ground, and sure enough, he sticks a pause in there right away again. So we go, what is it, you know? And then he does it again, and then when he, the third gesture, which is there's also something magical about three in music, about the number three in music, he doesn't even have the cellos and basses play it directly in time. He has them play a cello rondo, but they have to start slowly. The opening, the A, in that first symphony, which I like to call the tuning of the universe, it's so soft that we have to do a trick. We have to trick the audience because there's no big splash in the beginning of the Mahler 1. And so usually what I'll do is, which is too much information for the orchestra, I should only have to do that for the orchestra. But I do this on purpose because I want the audience to think that something has happened. And so they think, I'm not hearing it. And they start, and they're quiet, and then poof, comes the note right in the right place. That's a terrific point.
Wow, that's a good trick.
Yeah. There's a condition that I call young conductoritis, which manifests itself in a couple ways. One is young conductors talk too much. And young conductors, I mean in rehearsal, for example, and young conductors talk too much because they feel an overwhelming need to prove to the orchestra that they studied the score. The other thing that young conductors do is they overconduct. And they overconduct because we're trained, this is what we do, we're conducting, you know? And they also don't understand yet that they can really trust the orchestra. And sometimes it's better if we conduct less. I mean, there's a moment in the Freischutz that I did, the opening of the Freischutz overture. And I was in Detroit early on, and I went, this is how it goes. So I went, this is what I heard. I mean, I was long gone. And now when I do their Freischutz, I do it that way on purpose. Because what that means is, if I can get them to the downbeat of the second bar of that overture, if I go ahead and go to the downbeat of that overture, downbeat of that second bar, once they get there, I am simultaneously now not showing them where that bar is, but what the life of that note is after they play that ictus, after they play that downbeat of that bar. There are nights when I walk out of stage going, oh my gosh, this piece is 45 minutes long. You know that going in. But once the music starts, you're just there. Hopefully that you're there. You know, someone said that, I had a teacher once that said, if you're thinking about anything else, then you're no longer thinking about the music. And really, your job is to be thinking about the music. Oftentimes, what happens to me is that I'm just excited about what the audience gets to hear next.
I want to thank you all very much, and I especially want to thank our very special guest, Thomas Wilkins, for his wonderful answers. Thank you.